This is Eldest Souls. This game touts itself as a 2D boss rush Souls-like, which I actually disagree with on that last part a little bit, by the way. I don't think there's all that much Dark Souls DNA to be found here. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. The game has a pretty specific focus. I just think there are other equally important influences to be stated here, which I'll get onto when I get to those parts. But I do think that the main sort of Dark Souls-esque part of this game is the fact that you're dealing with quite complex boss fights and that dodge timing is very important. Which neither of those are things that are exclusive to Dark Souls. So if you're looking for the kinds of things that are normally in games that tout themselves as Souls-likes, right, like other more Dark Souls-like things, like a Estus Flask-like healing charge-based consumable thing, or some sort of soul system, or a death system where you have to go back to your body after you die every time to retrieve something, or a sort of Metroidvania-like almost sort of open world to explore, or, for instance, a large selection of different pieces of equipment and various stats that you can level up with your soul equivalent to create your build. All that sort of stuff that you generally tend to expect when you hear that term, that phrase, Souls-like, is not here. And once again, I'm not saying that as a negative, I'm just saying that, you know, Dark Souls didn't invent hard bosses or environmental storytelling. It just uses them extremely well. And there are other equally important influences here to be aware of. So how does this game work? Well, it's actually quite simple. You are just a singular character, always the same character, and always the same equipment. The game is mechanically simple at first, but there's actually a lot more to it than you might realize. You have a singular weapon and a specific set of characteristics with that weapon. You have a couple of basic swings, you have a charged attack, and you have this bloodthirst bar that fills up as you hit and maxes out if you hit with the charge attack. When it maxes out, you deal a lot more damage and also heal yourself by hitting enemies. And once it's full, you can also do this thing called a blood burst that expends the entire bar, but is one big hit of damage, and also, of course, the healing that comes along with it. You also have three dash bars that you can use, so you can dash up to three times in quick succession before having to wait for them to refill. And if you dash through an attack, the dashes will refill much, much faster, so you're heavily rewarded for dashing through attacks accurately, not just for avoiding damage, but because it allows you to dash through further attacks much more quickly. And of course, you've also got a health gauge, very important because you don't want to die, but you will, quite often. In fact, because this game is actually quite challenging, in my opinion, and the health gauge is deceptively small. You can't take a lot of damage in this game, that is of course deliberate. Bosses can sometimes kill you in as little as 3 hits, depending on what you actually get hit by, and this actually makes the gameplay a lot more similar to something like a 2D version of Bloodborne, because it is highly aggressive. This is not a passive game, you do not have a shield, you do not have a block. There is a counter move, but we'll get onto that in a minute. And you're encouraged to be on the offensive, to be attacking all the time, because you want to be filling this bloodthirst gauge, since that is your only method of healing. You do not have a consumable or a potion or an Estus Flask or anything like that that heals yourself. You have to heal by doing damage with this bar full. You have to land charge attacks to go into bloodthirst mode, and then start just wailing on enemies to get health back. This is why I say it's a lot more like Bloodborne mechanically, because it's a game that doesn't reward passivity, that doesn't have any sort of guard or anything like that, and instead rewards being aggressive. When you get hit by an attack, you don't want to hang back and chug a flask, you want to dash for the enemy and start smacking them as much as possible to get your health back. Now here's where all the variety comes in. You might expect that a game with only one weapon doesn't have that much build variety, but there's actually a surprisingly very large amount of build variety in this game despite that, because you also have three different skill trees. You can choose one of these skill trees at a time, and each of them represents a specific set of mechanics that you can add to your character to enhance what you can do, and they each sort of involve different sorts of playstyles. So first you have the Windslide skill tree, which is based around dodging a lot. This makes it to where as you hit bosses, you will unleash these things called wind leaves, which are these seeking green projectiles that will do chip damage over time and help you to be dealing damage even while you're dodging, because as long as you stay relatively aggressive, you'll have several of these in the air at any given time, so even when you're not attacking, they're still bombarding the enemy for you and doing small amounts of damage. As these hit your enemy, you will charge up this wind slide gauge, and once it's at least 75% full, you can use it to trigger the wind slide itself, which is a really nice move because it's an attack that also doubles as a dodge, since it's effectively like a long distance slide attack. You can slide through an enemy, which will do a whole bunch of damage to them, as well as unleash a whole bunch of these wind leaves. So you can use it to just do burst damage to an enemy, or you can use it as an extra dodge if your other dodges are currently recharging and you really need to get out of the way of something. You can input your skill points on this tree to do things like make the wind leaves do more damage, make them heal you, add a special effect every time you do a perfect dodge through an attack that gives you a flurry of attacks instead of just a single slash for a second. There's all sorts of different upgrades to the various wind leaves and how they work. That's how the skill trees work. They sort of improve the main mechanic of that skill tree. And then you have the Berserk slash skill tree, which involves an entirely aggressive playstyle. No dodging, just pure aggression, as many charge attacks as possible, chaining charge attacks, and bloodthirst hits and blood bursts as much as possible for like just pure burst damage. It's all about aggression. As you hit enemies in this style, you will gain these fangs, which will up your overall damage by 5% each, and you can expend a fang to go into this Berserk slash mode where all of your attacks will fire out these extra damaging shockwaves that you can use the skill tree to imbue extra characteristics onto, and also to generate special collectible power-up things on the battlefield that will up your damage even further, and you stack up these percentage damage increases to do like huge burst damage, basically. So it's just pure aggression. And then you have the counter skill tree, which is pretty much exactly what you would think. It is your most defensive one, despite not having a guard, and involves timing countered attacks very well to do like tons of burst and defend yourself from extra attacks by like shielding your health gauge to give yourself a couple of extra like free hits worth of shield and stuff like that. So this would be your main defensive playstyle option. But in addition to all of these skill trees and the various mechanics and bonuses and passives that they involve, there is also a secondary way to improve yourself, and that is with shards. Every time you beat a boss, you get one skill point to spend on your skill tree, and you get a shard of that boss, sort of like a boss soul. And these shards involve some sort of thematic power that the boss used against you. So the boss that uses all light attacks is of course going to give you a shard involving light attacks. And the way this works is exactly like Transistor, where every one of these shards represents an active skill that you can use and a bunch of passive additions to other skills if you want to use it there instead. You have these various different shard slots on your equipment screen, and you can either put them in your active slot, so they'll be on the right trigger and they will involve some sort of active attack that you can do, or you can put them into other passive slots and they will make a thematic change to that passive effect. So things like improving your charge attack with one of them, or improving your blood burst with one of them, or improving your dodge with one of them. You can also slot them into the actual mechanic that you're using to improve things like your wind slash and your berserk slashes and things, and you can even put them on the end of the two skill tree paths once you reach the bottom and get enough skill points to improve that particular mechanic. So there are a lot of options here. Every single shard has a whole bunch of different uses. And like I said, they all tend to be thematically connected. So for instance, the boss that is a god of duality, a sort of fire and water orb, all of its attacks involve two different stages, depending on where you set it. They involve doing a fire attack at when you're above 50% HP, that will improve whatever you slot it into with flames to do a bunch of extra damage, but it will hurt you in some way. And if you're below 50% HP, it will imbue whatever you're doing with water and actually heal you in some way. So this is where the really genuinely impressive build variety of the game comes in, since every single one of these shards can be slotted into any of the shard locations and have a different effect there. You can come up with all kinds of different builds, depending on which of the three skill trees you're using, which direction of the skill tree you're going, since each one has two different branches, and of course which of these shard paths you are filling up with what shards. You can end up as a completely different character. Despite having the same weapon as everyone else, you might play entirely differently, and I think that's a really cool bit of build variety, having these sort of transistor-like shard effects allowing you to use them as actives or modify passive aspects of yourself with them to create an overall build. So how are the boss fights themselves? Well, although there's definitely some Souls-like influence in the boss fights, I see where they're coming from, I actually think that a lot of the influence comes from stuff like MMO raid bosses and stuff, because a lot of the mechanics of these boss fights actually remind me more of like a 2D version of that, and I think it's really, really cool. The boss fights are genuinely challenging. Almost all of them are multi-phase, and the ones that aren't multi-phase tend to have some sort of gimmick that technically makes them multi-phase anyway, and they have a lot of different mechanics. Each fight is entirely mechanically different from every other fight. None of them feel like they reuse gimmicks or anything like that. They're all completely different from each other, and they're all quite complex, almost puzzle-like encounters that you have to figure out. Learning the tells of each various attack and learning the dodge timings of each attack is very important, every boss having quite a large repertoire of possible attacks they can throw at you. From the crazy dual boss that I mentioned earlier, which seesaws effectively between water and fire attacks, leaving fire on the ground that can damage you, but you have to make sure to bait its water attacks over that fire so it'll cool it down and allow you to actually move around again, to a light using boss where you have to memorize the patterns between the different flashes between white or red light and would know which attack is coming, which side of the battlefield is going to be covered in light that you have to dodge away from, which beams are going to sweep where that you have to dodge through, a frost using boss that actually stacks up a debuff on you over time as you get hit by its various attacks that tend to have like sweeping effects, so you have time to dodge away from them. But if you get enough stacks of this frost on you, it'll limit your movement speed and your ability to dodge, and eventually the cycles will go through and it'll have this big ice spike attack from the ground, and you have to make sure that you have at least one dodge left over for that, because it can almost one-shot you if you're not at completely full health. It does tremendous damage, and he will also be spawning icicles on the side of the battlefield with all of his other attacks that will just hover there out of the way for a while, and then when he transitions phases, all of these icicles will collide in. You have to remember where they are. A lot of these concepts, a lot of these mechanics are very like MMO raid boss-like. Just read up a Final Fantasy 14 raid boss instruction, like how to beat them, and you'll see a lot of mechanics like these being used. That's why I think that sort of idea of like a raid boss is actually a lot more accurate than like a Souls-like boss in this case, because they genuinely feel like 2D raid bosses, and it's done super well, actually. I think it's really freaking cool how much stuff, how many mechanics, and how each one feels very unique and self-contained and different from the rest that they've been able to cram into these boss battles and make them feel very action-y, very full, very dense with mechanics to learn, despite not actually lasting too long. I never felt that any of the bosses overstayed their welcome, that any of the bosses were too tanky and took too long to kill. You might feel that in the first couple of tries of a boss, but for the most part, once you actually hit your stride and you start dodging more effectively and you start using charge attacks more effectively and you sort of, you know, learn what you're doing with that boss, you'll figure out that actually they all go down relatively quickly. None of the bosses take like a bajillion hits to die. They're not super overly tanky. They're just difficult, and they have a lot of mechanics to learn, and you have to actually be on your toes to go around all these attacks because you can't face tank them, you just don't have that much health, and of course you will have to heal back any damage you take by putting yourself at further risk and wailing on the boss to regain your health. So I actually think the game mechanically is extremely solid and very, very competent. The boss fights are genuinely a triumph. It feels great to beat them, and they are just really mechanically interesting, and like I said, they're so different from each other that you never know what's coming next, and you just want to get to the next one and figure out what's going to happen. You want to meet that next wall that you're going to be bashing your head into for the next, you know, 10 tries to get through it, because it's satisfying to actually meet them and learn all their attacks, and it's extra satisfying to finally apply that knowledge and execute a really successful boss fight, get through them to the next one, and do it all over again. I would say that for a boss rush game, this game does exactly what it needs to do. It's laser focus on that one topic, on just bosses, means that its balance is really, really good. The variety and skills and various things that your character can do all serve that one singular purpose of getting you through boss fights. So that means the overall balance of the game can be a lot more focused on just that specific thing. There are no adds, really. There are no other enemies to face. It's just boss after boss and a small world to explore. And that means that overall the pacing of the game is excellent and works really well. Now, the world does have some things to do. As I mentioned, there is some environmental storytelling in this game, and the lore is actually quite interesting, so it's worth talking to the characters that you find and getting the other items from like optional paths and stuff like that, and you can turn these items into various NPCs to unlock more dialogue or to unlock more of the story, and some of them even give you extra things that help you in battle, like for instance, a crow familiar that absorbs the damage you take and then every 15 seconds releases 150% of that damage in a big burst around you. That takes a little while to get to that, but you can get that, so it is actually worth, you know, there are some other gameplay benefits aside from just story if you're not as interested in that, in exploring the world. Overall, I think this is a very fantastic game. It does exactly what it sets out to do very well. It is an excellent boss rush RPG with a good amount of build variety and some really fun mechanics, and most importantly, the boss fights are awesome. They're challenging but not unfair, they're fun to learn, and they don't feel, you know, random or nonsensical or overly artificially difficult. They feel like they were balanced and created with a steady hand and a deft mind that knows how to make a complex boss fight interesting and not annoying. Also, the soundtrack to this game is really good, as you would hope for in a game like this. You know, excellent boss fights often come with excellent music, and in this case, that's very much true. The music is great, and each boss has its own theme. So that is Eldest Souls. I think it's absolutely worth playing. It is a fantastic boss rush RPG that you deserve to experience if you're a fan of more hardcore RPGs like this. The bosses are genuinely very fun to learn, and it's a really good feeling to beat them and move on to the next one. You'll notice I mostly just showed you earlier stages of the boss fights in this video. That's because since this game is all about boss fights, I didn't want to just spoil you on everything that you're going to see, how some of the later phases work, how some bosses change into entirely new bosses, and of course the really late game stuff. I'm saving all of that for you to find yourself. So check it out in the description below this video if you would like to do so. Thank you guys very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.